So this morning, let's start our service and praise God together with this hymn, May the Peoples Praise Him. Great to be able to praise the Lord together, isn't it? And I don't know if there's been a lot of other praising going on over in Tokyo. How many of you have been getting stuck into the Olympics since last week? It's been a lot of success for Team GB, hasn't it? Now, I must confess, I'm a bit of an Olympics geek. I've always been into the Olympics, and I went and visited the Olympics Museum in Lausanne when I was in Switzerland a few years ago. And I love the fact that it's more than just a sports contest. I mean, for those that don't know, it's got a long history, the Olympic Games, and it's really about celebrating international togetherness and international community. And the whole village is set up to be that, to be a place where nations can make friends with each other. In normal times, it would be one dining hall where all the athletes would all eat together. There's no fancy hotels where, you know, all the teams go and in their own little silos. It's very much a very supportive and community environment for the athletes. And you can see, can't you, that they really do support each other. You know, they all know what it means to win a medal. And when one nation or one competitor does well, you do see that camaraderie, that great spirit amongst them. I suppose I find it, you contrast it perhaps to the England football team, who were runners up and did amazingly well to be in the final. And yet as soon as those medals were put round their necks, many of them immediately took them off. Whereas in the Olympics, just to have a medal of any colour is seen as an achievement to those athletes that are taking place. And I don't know if you watched the opening ceremony on Friday, it would have been, I think, last week. It was obviously subdued because of COVID. There was lots of things that they couldn't do. But one moment that stood out for me was when it was announced that the Olympic motto was being changed. Now, this is a motto that stood for decades. The International Olympic Committee had a vote and unanimously decided to change it. And it's now, it used to be faster, higher, stronger, you know, reflecting what the Olympics is all about, but they've decided to add an extra word on the end. And the motto is now faster, higher, stronger together, to reflect what the Games is about and what society really should now be doing. And before the vote, the IOC president said that solidarity fuels our mission to make the world a better place through sport. We can only go faster, we can only aim higher, we can only become stronger by standing together in solidarity. And I thought that was a really lovely way of just saying what the power of sport is all about. And aside from sport, even if you're not a sports person, I think it's a lovely message for life, but very much a message, I think, for society as a whole after everything that we've been through over the last 18 months. And it reminded me of a verse in Ecclesiastes, which chapter 4, verses 9 to 12, where it says, two people are better off than one, for they can help each other succeed. If one person falls, the other can reach out and help. But someone who falls alone is in real trouble. Likewise, two people lying close together can keep each other warm, but how can one be warm alone? A person standing alone can be attacked and defeated, but two can stand back to back and conquer. Three are even better, for a triple braided cord is not easily broken. And I think, as I say, there's this wider lesson. We've spoken a lot in the decisions we've made recently as a church about how there's been such a sense of unity. And that really feels like that's something that has come through our church lately, and I think is important for any churches. We should be a fellowship together. And it's where there's a lack of togetherness where there is a problem. We need to look outside our own sphere and look at people not as different, but try and work with them together. And in that sense, Mercy and Abe, I want to look outside of our little sphere here. And Mercy and Abe are going to bring our prayers for us this morning. But
our gracious and our loving Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord, in humility, seeking your face. As your word says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, will forgive their sin and heal their land. Father God, be humble before you this morning. You are a great and mighty God. We want to thank you, Lord, that you have given us this opportunity to gather together as a community of your believing people, offering up our sacrifice of praise, sacrifice of thanksgiving for your goodness and for your greatness. We've been singing your praises. Great is the Lord, and more greatly to be praised. Father, we give you thanks. You are a God who dwells in the midst of the praises of your people coming down upon us. What a privilege that we all have. Many people don't have it, but as your believing people, you come down, a God who stoops to make your presence in each one of your people. You made your body to be your dwelling place. We want to thank you for it, Lord. We bless your holy name. We've just heard, even through these times when we are going through this, the games, and what we've heard, it's all about achieving. Lord, physically, we want to thank you for reminding us, Lord, as an international community. But we look through the Word of God. We know, Lord, that spiritually also we are a community. And we are reminded of your word through the writer to the Hebrews, who says, since to all God's people, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes upon Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Through this, Lord, we humble before you for what you have done on our behalf. We want to thank you for it, Lord. Tonight we pray, as we continue to be in your presence, you will minister to each one of us in this congregation. You know our needs. Lord Jesus, even as we heard Rona speaking through your word, a threefold cord will never be broken. It is your spirit that is binding us together with cords of your love that can never be broken. For we ask it in Jesus' most precious and holy name. Amen.
I came across an old hymn that I just wanted to read to all of us. O breath of life, come sweeping through us. Revive your church with life and power. O breath of life, come cleanse, renew us, and fit your church to meet this hour. O wind of God, come bend us, break us, till humbly we confess our need. Then in your tenderness, remake us, revive, restore, for this we plead. O breath of love, come breathe within us, renewing thought and will and heart. Come, love of Christ, afresh to win us. Revive your church in every part. Revive us, Lord. Is zeal abating while harvest fields are vast and white? Revive us, Lord. The world is waiting. Equip your church to spread the light. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Abe and Mercy, for sharing with us this morning. And let's sing again together. It's an old chorus, I think, that I wasn't familiar with, but I found that the words were very appropriate and actually echo what Mercy has just read. So it's a little chorus called Father, Make Us One. I don't know if some of you might know it, but let's sing together again. Very simple chorus, but I hope you agree that the words are very important. Jesus and the thief on the cross next to him couldn't have been more different. They weren't from the same sphere. They weren't alike at all. And yet Jesus promised that thief on the cross that he would be with him together in paradise. And Andy Scarcliffe is going to look at that now for us this morning.
Well, it's good to be with you in Galashiels again this morning. I've got a couple of one-off sermons that I'm going to do this week and next week. And this morning we're going to be looking at the thief on the cross. I've not often preached on this character, but I was reading about him during the week, and he just captured my imagination. The whole, all that is invested in this few verses in Luke chapter 23, and the way that it illustrates God's incredible grace, God's amazing grace. So let's read the passage, Luke chapter 23, verses 32 to 43. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." And the soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you're the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the king of the Jews." And one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him, "Don't you fear God, since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." This is another illustration of God's amazing grace. There are so many examples of God's amazing grace that we find in the scriptures. I think that's why Amazing Grace is such a popular hymn, because it's fed by all of these incredible stories about people whose lives were turned around, not by their own merits, but by God's amazing grace. In fact, Amazing Grace has been recorded multiple times. Elvis Presley recorded it, Willie Nelson, even the Grateful Dead. Judy Collins, of course, had a top 10 hit in the 60s, singing Amazing Grace, and it was even sung at Spock's funeral in Star Trek II. So quite a wide treatment of a wonderful hymn, and it's because it captures the hearts of so many people. It captures something in there because we all know deep down that we depend upon Amazing Grace. So here is a man who experienced this amazing grace hanging on the cross next to Jesus. Let's ask the question, who were these thieves? What do we know about them? Well, the word that Luke uses in his gospel describes not just someone who's been caught pilfering because he was trying to feed his family because they were hungry. No, these were serious criminals. They were members of the criminal class, professional criminals, members of the underworld. Hoodlums, thugs, killers, men who killed for fun and profit, assassins. That's what the word actually means that Luke uses to describe these two characters on the cross. And some commentators even suggest that they may have been terrorists. So if you mix the mafia with ISIS, you've got a good feel for where these guys are coming from. Serious characters and serious criminals. And of course, Jesus told the story about the thief. I mean, Jesus stayed with his disciples for about 40 days after the resurrection, before the ascension. And I'm sure that he must have sat down and told them many of the stories that we read in the Gospels that we have no other way of knowing apart from the mouth of Jesus. So I can imagine Jesus sitting at a campfire with his disciples one night before the ascension, after the resurrection, and saying, "Let me tell you about this character that I spoke to on the cross, the one that asked for my forgiveness." And so we see in this dialogue, this conversation between the dying thief and Jesus, we see amazing faith and amazing grace. It's one thing to know that God's grace is amazing, but if we don't access it by faith, then it's not much good to us. If you know about God's amazing grace and all that he's done for you and his son coming to die for you, but you've never actually expressed faith in that, then it's kind of pointless. It's an academic reality that you've not accessed. It needs to become experience. And that's exactly what this man does. Amazing faith. He says, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Now, he's dying in agony for crimes committed. The case has been tried, the judgment has been pronounced, and the sentence is being carried out. All purely legal avenues, presumably, have been explored and exhausted. And so he's now facing his judgment. And at the last moment, he makes a bold appeal to the judge of all men. Not some earthly human judge, but the judge of all men, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who will judge all mankind. He speaks to him and he says, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Now, this is an audacious request, if it were not for the fact that that's exactly what Jesus wants us to do, to ask for his mercy, to ask for his grace, and to ask for his salvation. It's one of the most amazing examples of saving faith in the entire Bible. Let me read a graphic portrayal of this man's experience by one writer. The man's feet and arms are nailed to the cross. Ropes hold his body upright so it won't fall off. Every movement is agony, every breath torture. Beneath him and behind him, the howling mob screams for blood. They jeer, they hiss, they curse, they spit, they roar like wild hyenas. They cheer as he coughs up blood. They shout with approval when someone aims a rock at a piece of tender flesh. It is garish, hellish, brutal, and inhuman. Listen to this. Yet it is here, amid the blood and gore, that this man comes to faith. However low you might think, I might think, there is still the possibility of looking up and saying, remember me, Lord. Save me, Lord. Have mercy on me, Lord, because that's exactly what this man is doing. Amazing faith and amazing grace. But let's think a bit this morning about the object of his faith, because he sees Jesus at his weakest moments. Now, as far as we know, he never heard Jesus preaching the Sermon on the Mount. He never saw him healing a blind man in the street. He never saw him feeding the 5,000. He never saw him calming the storm. He never saw him walking on the water. He never saw him raising Lazarus from the dead. If he'd been at any of those events, I could imagine him saying, oh my goodness me, this guy must be the Messiah. This guy must be something special. Remember me, Jesus, when you come in your kingdom. But no, he sees Jesus at his weakest moments. As far as we know, he never knew anything about the virgin birth. He knew nothing about the teachings in the Old Testament about the Messiah. He knew nothing of the conversation with Nicodemus. He knew nothing of the miracle of resurrection that was about to take place. Such basic faith, but the object of his faith is Jesus. And he reaches out to him and he says, remember me when you come in your kingdom. And it's faith the size of a grain of mustard seed, really. Because he says, remember me when you come in your kingdom. He obviously has faith in the person of Christ. If we try and explore, how much did he really understand? And it's hard to be objective and final about what's going on here, because it's such a short conversation. But I can imagine he had faith in the person of Christ, because he says in verse 41, he says to his friend, his friend mocks Jesus. But he rebukes his friend, verse 41, and he says, "We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." Now, he may have just meant, "I think he's a pretty good guy." But something in me suggests that the Holy Spirit had revealed something to him. The Holy Spirit was active in this process. It wasn't just a dialogue. It wasn't just a philosophical conversation. It wasn't just desperation. I think we have to assume that the Holy Spirit somehow opened his heart and enabled him to see, even in his agony, as he looks at this man on the cross next to him, that here is someone that he can trust in, he can receive from, he can ask from. And he says, "This man has done nothing wrong." I dare to believe that that is a demonstration of his belief in the faith in the person of Christ. But faith in the power of Christ. He says, "Jesus, remember me." He's talking about something personal here. He says, "Remember me." It's not just when you get to your kingdom. I'll be somewhere there in the crowd, so perhaps you could try and remember me. There is something quite personal about this request. He's saying, "Remember me. Remember me." And Jesus' response is, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." And the wording in the Greek is, the phrase means to be with me in a very personal way. Not just, you are over there somewhere in the crowd and I'll remember that you're there somewhere as I am in heaven, as I rule, as I take my throne. No, there's something quite personal here. What the phrase means is, you and me together, side by side, you will be with me in paradise. Wherever Jesus was going, this thief, this criminal, this reprobate would be walking forgiven, cleansed, healed with eternal life right by Jesus' side. That's the implication of Jesus' promise, you will be with me in paradise. So he's got faith in the power of Christ, and Christ's response is, yes, I will remember you and you will be with me in that very personal way. And there's an idea of immediate salvation here. He doesn't have to wait or trust that sometime in the future, maybe after judgment day, there'll be mercy for him. He says, Jesus puts today in the original language, today comes first. Today, you will be, this very day, the day of your crucifixion. That's what Jesus means when he says, this day you will be with me in paradise. And he seems to have some faith in the coming kingdom of Christ, because when he says, remember me when you come into your kingdom, some kind of concept, some kind of belief that Jesus, if he is a king, he must have some kind of kingdom. He may have gleaned some of this from hearing people talk about Jesus, even some of the things that were said as he hung on the cross. And this word paradise is a crucial word to understand what Jesus is promising here. It originally referred to the walled gardens of the Persian kings. And when a king wanted to honor his subjects, he would invite them to walk with him in his garden in the cool of the day. So it's a description of a king walking in his walled garden, giving a special honor to one of his subjects. That's the way that this phrase comes across. That's the background to it. The same word was used in the Greek Old Testament to refer to the Garden of Eden. Remember God the Father walking with Adam and Eve in the cool of the day. And in Revelation chapter 2, verse 7, it refers to heaven. And it is a place of beauty, openness, and inexpressible blessedness. And that's the word that's used here. And so his promise in response to when you come into your kingdom, Jesus says, this day you will be with me in paradise. There's this picture of the king giving special honor to one of his subjects. He's not getting saved by the skin of his teeth. He's not getting saved begrudgingly. He's not, Jesus isn't saying, well, I'm in the business of forgiving people, so I suppose I'll have to let you in. No, no. Here is a picture of a king giving special honor to the one who does not deserve an inch of it. He's promising it to him. What a day was this for this criminal. In the morning, he's in prison. At noon, he's hanging on a cross. And by sundown, he is in paradise. In the morning, he's in prison. At noon, he's hanging on a cross. And by sundown, he is in paradise. An amazing picture of amazing grace. It's salvation independent of sacraments, church, good works. It's salvation independent of joining a Baptist church, Church of Scotland, Methodist church, any kind of church. It's salvation independent of being baptized, going through a discipleship course, doing an Alpha course, doing the prayer course. He didn't have the facility to do any of that. It's simply based on the word of Jesus, whose word is truth, because Jesus is the truth. And I wonder if I can apply this to us this morning as we finish this little study, that some of us perhaps feel that there have been things that we have done that we wish we had not done, and we can't get rid of them in our memories, things that we said. And if only we could go back to that time in our life and rub that day out, eradicate that day, get rid of it, forget it. If only I hadn't done that. If only I hadn't said that, thought that, initiated that course of action, started that relationship, whatever it might be. And maybe that had repercussions. Maybe it had a knock-on effect. Maybe it had consequences. But this story tells us that even if we have no way whatsoever to put right the wrongs done, God's amazing grace is there for us. And Jesus' promise and Jesus' word and Jesus' mercy is there for us. There may be someone who's listening, and I don't know where you stand. There may be someone who has never asked Jesus to be Lord of their life. It may be that you're connected with the church in some way. Maybe you've always come, but you've never really given your life fully to Jesus in salvation. And it's because maybe you think you're not good enough. Well, are you better than the thief? Are you just a wee bit better than this mafia character, this terrorist, this guy who had no chance to do anything to earn his salvation apart from trusting Jesus? And Jesus' promise is, this day you will be with me in paradise. Jesus' promise to you is that you can be assured of his forgiveness, his cleansing, and his kingdom. Let's pray together. Father, some of us perhaps have never asked you to come into our lives. We've never asked you to be Lord. Maybe there's someone here listening. Maybe perhaps someone who's never been to Galashiels Baptist Church, but they've just come across this Zoom meeting because someone recommended it to them, or maybe they just accessed it by mistake. Either way, perhaps there is someone who, like the dying thief, desperately wants that amazing grace. And on their behalf, I would like to ask, Father, that you would come and be their Savior, be their Lord, cleanse their sins, come into their life and fill them to overflowing with your amazing grace. And those of us, Lord, who are your people, and for some reason cannot, do not fully believe or understand the unconditional nature of your love and forgiveness. Even though it's written on every page of the Bible, we still struggle with that. And I just pray that you would come close to all such people that are listening right now, that they might hear and believe and trust that one day they will walk with you in the cool of the garden, in paradise, in heaven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you all, and I will see you all next week.
Thank you to Andy for this morning's message. And as we reflect on his words, I just wanted to play you a version of that song, that hymn that he mentioned, Amazing Grace. This particular version was filmed during the pandemic, during a time when we were very much not together, as this video demonstrates. But God's amazing love and God's amazing grace is a gift that we've all been given, as Andy says. It's a gift that we have the power to use. We should use this as a catalyst to reach out to those amongst us and not be alone, because we are all together in Christ, and by working together we can be stronger, as that previous video says. So there is no words on this video, but I know that a lot of you know the words, so if you want to sing along then do, but if not, just listen. It's Andrea Bocelli that's singing. Just reflect on just how blessed we are to have God's amazing grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears raised. Within the air.
Lord, thank you for your amazing grace that allows us to be able to think of a time when we will walk with you in paradise, Lord. But until that day, Lord, thank you that we are never alone. We are always together with you, Lord. And we thank you for the communities around us that we are part of that help us not to feel alone. And we just pray, Lord, in these coming weeks, Lord, as we start to hopefully emerge from this pandemic, Lord, that this sense of togetherness, this sense of unity will be something that we use to reach out to those amongst us who do feel alone, who don't feel together, Lord, and who really would love to have your amazing grace in their lives, Lord. So be with us all as we go through the next weeks and days, Lord. Bless us all this morning in your name. Amen.